Just and true are your you have a pick.
Oh my goodness. Welcome. We are so glad that you are here this morning. Hope you are enjoying pictures from Falls Creek. We'll have a report in just a little bit, but I got to tell you, God is good. God is good all the time. Even in the midst of troubles, it doesn't matter. And today we're going to stand and we're going to praise him because he is worthy of everything that we have. Join us now.
Thank you. Good morning, Grandview. You can have a seat. We have a few announcements we want to make for you and let you know of a few things. Obviously, today is Father's Day. To all your fathers, stand here and give yourself a pat on the back. You've done a great job. Listen, have you guys ever noticed? Listen, fathers get no respect. I mean, Mother's Day, the lights shine, the flowers are out, and on Father's Day, everybody just says, hey, how you doing? So anyway, listen, we have a gift for our dads this morning. So if you will pick that up, where's that at? It will be on the back table. So we have a gift for you. And we just want to let you know how glad we are to have dads here. So we're gonna make a little investment in you. So anyway, we appreciate that. Moving on, we do want to let you know that Children's Camp is upcoming. That's going to be on July the 3rd through the 6th. Or no, people who have completed the 3rd through the 6th grade. That's what I get for reading ahead. Camp is going to be July 5th through the 8th. You see the cost there. And if you would like to sign up, you can sign up at the Welcome Center just right out front if you would like to go to camp. Now, we're going to have two meetings where we need a parent guardian there for that meeting. The first one is going to be on June the 25th at 5 o'clock p.m. And the next one is going to be on Wednesday, June the 28th at 6:30 p.m. All of those, one of two of those meetings is very, very essential. So we want to let you know about that. Also, we want to thank you for your generosity, those who help support Falls Creek Scholarships. We will need Children's Camp scholarships, so those who can help out with Children's Camp, we would appreciate that. You'll need to designate your offering for the Children's Camp Scholarship. Make sure you get that to us, and we want to bring as many kids as possible. I was looking at the list. Pam, it's already expanded. What in the world? I mean, we've got a big group. It's going to be fun, and we'll be going out to Disney. So anyway, Disney Camp in Disney, Oklahoma. Don't get any illusions here. So anyway, but it's still great. Our kids have a great time every time we go there, and we are looking forward to that. So we had a big week. I want to tell you, listen, Falls Creek was great as always. It was about the coolest it's ever been as far as the weather goes that I can remember. I left only partially crippled, so this is a good thing. In fact, on my final night, this is me playing my violin so you can feel sorry for me. My final night, I slept on the top bunk, and my wife stayed with me in the pastor's quarters. And so we had a ladder set up right off to the side. And so about 3 in the morning, I had to get down, and I climbed for whatever reason. It was the final night. My stance wasn't as steady. And the ladder fell over, and I fell on the ground. I busted my knees, busted my elbows, busted my... Why are you laughing at me? I'm still trying to get you to feel sorry for me. And then I hit my head, and I was on the ground. I was going, and Katrina woke up, and she's like, "Oh, are you okay?" And my answer was, "Oh," and she went back to sleep. I think she just assumed I said yes. So anyway, great camp. We loved it. We enjoyed it. Pray for my wife. God needs to give her an abundance of mercy for her poor husband. Anyway, all right, listen. Great week. Brother Jay, let's get our group up here, and we're going to go ahead and talk about Falls Creek. Can we do that? Let's do that. We'll pray when we're done. Come on.
I didn't ask anybody to come up, so I think if you, we wore really muted colored shirts this year. I don't know if you'll be able to pick us out, but look around for shirts that are kind of like mine, and we had a great week at camp. It was fantastic. The Lord answered prayers from beginning to end. We prayed for cool weather, and He provided. We prayed for salvations, He provided. We prayed for the Holy Spirit to move and to bring our groups together. We brought 20 from our from Grandview and 20 from Porter, and the groups got along great. There was almost no trouble at all, and the Lord provided. He answered our prayers. He answered your prayers, and I'm really grateful for everything that took place this year. We had 2 salvations. If you got saved at camp and you want to share that, you're welcome to stand up. If not, that's okay. We know who you are, and we're going to be praying for you. I do want to thank our cooks. Laurie and Beth, give them a hand, please. It's amazing the amount of work that they put into that, and it was great. The food was fantastic. I want to thank all of the sponsors, Jeff and Angie and Pam and Brother Jay and Katrina, and just Angie, everybody. I knew I was forgetting someone. They made it happen. Guys, you really, I say it every year, but it's the truth. I don't do anything. I stand around watching all them work, and they are amazing. They make camp happen. And so they deserve a round of applause as well. Thank you very much. And I want to thank all of you. You guys made it work. You made it happen. You provided powerfully for the scholarships, and the tabernacles went well. We had some issues. It's camp. You're taking 40 teenagers to camp. You're going to have some issues here and there. But overall, it was a fantastic week. We were just really blessed. Did any of the sponsors want to add anything? Am I missing anything?
I just want to say something. Of course, I want to say something. We did have a couple of issues. And what I want to say is, even through those issues, God showed us what we needed to do and how things beyond that got handled that otherwise would not have been handled.
So I'm thankful that even when we think we know exactly how things want to go, he has a different plan for us, and he brought things to the surface that we needed to take care of in the lives of some of our young people, and hopefully we did exactly what we needed to do. But so even when things weren't going exactly right, God is still good. Guys, it was an incredible week, and we want to thank you for sponsoring so many of our kids, because without your help and without your tithing, we would not be able to buy groceries, we would not be able to have the kids go to camp and to have provide for them in a way that only God can. So thank you so much.
Amen. Yeah, it was powerful. It was great, and we're just very thankful to the Lord and to all of you for everything that you did. So, thank you.
Amen. Well, praise the Lord. Stuff happens. God's good. Let's stand. We'll open our time, continue our time with a word of prayer, and then we'll continue. So good to see you. Lord, we love you. We thank you for this day. Speak to us in our time together. Lord, may we lift up the name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. He's the reason we're here. He's the reason we do camp. He's the reason we love. And Father, I pray that we would worship him today and you in spirit and truth. And we ask this now in Christ's name. Amen and amen.
God showed his love among us. He sent his one and only Son into the world that we might live through him. This is love. Not that we loved God, but that he loved us and sent his Son as an atoning sacrifice for our sins.
Amen.
Make a wretched treasure. Please join me in a prayer. Father in heaven, as we've just sung, how deep is the Father's love for us, Father, we are truly grateful that you do love us, Father. Father, we praise you, God, for that love and how you provided salvation for us. Forgive us for the times that maybe we take that for granted. Father, we are truly thankful for the atoning work of Jesus Christ. Thank you for that precious shed blood that was poured out on Calvary that washes us white as snow. Thank you, God. And as many of us in our Sunday school hour studied on worship, how our worship continues on through godly living, I pray that this morning when the service is over that our worship won't end there, Father, but we would go throughout the rest of the week, throughout the rest of our lives, Father, in godly living, knowing that that's a portion of our worship to you, God. Father, I pray this morning that you continue to bless our church. I pray that you would richly bless the reading, the preaching, and the hearing of your word this morning through our pastor, Brother Jay. And I just ask all these things in the mighty name of Jesus. Amen.
Right, amen. As our ushers finish taking up our morning offering, take your Bibles and turn with me. Unless you have the plate in your hand, you can't turn, but after that. 1 John chapter 2, look with me beginning in verse 9. 1 John chapter 2, beginning in verse 9, read with me the words of the Apostle John. The Bible says, "He who says that he is in the light and hates his brother is in darkness until now, and he who loves his brother abides in the light. And there is no cause for stumbling in him. But he who hates his brother is in darkness and walks in darkness and does not know where he is going because the darkness has blinded his eyes." The theme as we've started looking through this book, 1 John, has been loving loud and how important it is for us, and we're reminded or to be reminded that we are to be loving loud. And sadly, in our day, this is not a normal theme. In fact, many people prefer to love less. You say, how do you know? Get caught in a traffic jam sometime. Amen. Drive through a construction zone in Tulsa. You'll see that, and you'll know that. And John speaks about the tragedy of going in the opposite direction of God's perfect plan for our life and the perfect plan for the life of the church when we choose to love less. So I want to talk with you this morning about three tragic results of a loveless life. Love must be the key, folks. I'm telling you, listen, love and the love that we are to have for God and the love that we are to have for other people is one of the most important things that you can ever do. It's an important thing that must happen with God's people. And we find here in the text that love is compared to light, and love and light go together, much like hate and darkness. And God calls us to this higher standard. So I want us to look real quickly this morning at these three tragic results of a loveless life. First of all, I want you to notice that it is tragic because of where you live. Verse 9 speaks about darkness. And you'll notice there in verse 9, we find that there are a lot of people who call themselves Christians, who talk the talk, but they can't walk the walk. Verse 9 speaks about this. It says, "He who says that he is in the light." And again, as I said, light is a recurring thing that you will find in the text. In fact, you find in 1 John 1 and verse 7, it says that if we walk in the light as he is in the light, we have fellowship with one another. We are called to walk in God's light. And when we walk in God's light, we as believers will have fellowship with one another and we'll have fellowship with God. 1 John 2 and verse 8 says that the true light is already shining. And oh my, how we love to talk about love in our churches, how we love to talk about this four-letter word in church, and yet so many times it goes in the other direction where it is the other four-letter word, the word hate. It's one thing to talk the talk, but it is another thing to walk the walk. Look in verse 9. It says this, he who says that he is in the light but hates his brother. Now I want you to notice this. There are two levels of love that we all have. Our first level of love that we should start with is the vertical level of love. Am I making sense? We're to love God. That is the first priority that we are all to have. We're to love him with all of our heart, with all of our soul, with all of our mind. And then the second is vertical. That's where we are. We're on the same level, right? We are to love one another. John speaks of both the vertical and the horizontal aspect of relationships that we have with one another. And he says that there are some who say that they walk in the light. In other words, that they love God, and yet at the same time, they hate their brother horizontally. I want to tell you this morning, and I may be so bold as to admit this and to say this, but it is impossible for us to be in fellowship with God, and out of fellowship with another Christian at the same time. You cannot be in fellowship with God and out of fellowship with another brother or sister in Jesus Christ. We are called to love. You say, well, you don't understand my circumstance. Let me say again, we are called to love. You say, well, you don't understand what this person said about me. Let me say again, we are called to love. You don't know what this other person did to me. You are called to love. You don't know how hateful that person is. You don't know how bad they hurt me, Brother Jay. Again, we are called to love. Jesus said, we are not only to talk the talk, but we are also to walk the walk. In his most famous sermon in Matthew chapter 5, turn over there with me if you will real quickly. Matthew chapter 5, I'm sure it's on the screen behind me, or will be. Maybe it's not. Matthew chapter 5, it says this, beginning in verse 21. Listen to what Jesus says in Matthew 5, beginning in verse 21. He says, you have heard that it was said to those of old, you shall not murder. Well, we can all say, well, I haven't done that. At least I hope we can, right? I have never, ever murdered. If there's anything that I can say, I have never murdered another person. But look at what Jesus says. He goes even deeper. You have heard it said to those of old, you shall not murder. That's one of the Ten Commandments. And whoever murders will be in danger of the judgment. But I say to you, listen to this, that whoever is angry with his brother without a cause shall be in danger of the judgment. And whoever says to his brother, Raca, shall be in danger of the council. But whoever says, you fool, shall be in danger of hell fire. Therefore, if you bring your gift to the altar, in other words, what he's about to say is, in our language, in the way that we would talk today, if you're trying to get right with God, and you know that you have a problem with another brother or sister in Christ, the thing that you need to do is go make it right with them first. Make it right with them. Or even if you can't, find a way in your heart to forgive them. Jesus said, listen, if we're going to talk like we're Christians, we need to walk like we're Christians. If we say that we want to be like Jesus, we need to act like Jesus. And Jesus was the most loving, forgiving person that ever walked on this planet. And he's the one, though I fall short of his glory and fall short of his pattern, he is the one that I am to attempt to pattern my life after. Am I making sense this morning? You see, when you choose not to love loud, but rather to love less, you're in danger of living in darkness. Verse 9 speaks of the person that hates his brother, and it says that he is in darkness until now. And the fact of the matter is, there are some Christians who are hateful, and yet they'll say, oh, how I love Jesus, or sing, oh, how I love Jesus on Sunday morning. And they think that they are in the light, and they think that they are walking in the light. But the truth of the matter is, if we take 1 John chapter 2 and verse 9 literally, which we ought to, amen, they're not walking in the light, they're walking in darkness. God calls us to walk in the light, and the only way that you can walk in the light is to love. The goal that we should all have is found in verse 10. It says, he who loves his brother abides in the light. Have any of you ever been offended in church? Am I the only one that's ever been offended in church? Have any of you ever had someone hurt your feelings in church? Oh, I have. You know, after my very first sermon, I was terrified. I want to tell you right now, I was terrified. I'm not naturally a type A personality. That's a forced thing that I've had to learn to do since I've become a pastor. And after my first sermon, I had someone come after me. And I want to tell you, listen, it was awful. I still have the tape, and I'm thinking about burning it. But after my first sermon that I thought was going to be 45 minutes ended up being 7 minutes, one of our dear, sweet saints in the church that I attended at that time came up, and I thought I was going to get encouraging words because, brothers and sisters, I needed it. And do you know what she said to me? She said, "Are you sure you're called to do this?" I want to tell you, that hurt my feelings. I had to learn to forgive that person. It took me a couple of weeks, Brother Jay, before I ever wanted to talk to him again. But we must love. We must forgive, even when people hurt our feelings. Sometimes people will hurt our feelings and they don't even realize that they've done it. Sometimes I've hurt people's feelings and I haven't realized that I've done it. And with the same measure of grace that we hope that people would extend towards us, we should extend the same measure to them. And it begins with love. If you choose to love loud, you'll honor God. But if you choose to love less, you will live in darkness. That's the first thing to remember. The second is this. Remember this with me this morning. It is tragic because of what you'll be. Turn back to 1 John with me, and I want you to notice what is said here in verse 10 of chapter 2. It says, "He who loves his brother abides in the light, and there is no cause for stumbling in him." Look at this word, stumbling. That's an important word that I don't want you to overlook. This describes a stumbling block. In fact, it's an interesting word in that it is translated a little differently in different translations. For instance, in the King James Version, it translates it this way. It calls it an occasion for stumbling. The New Living Translation says that we are not to cause anyone to stumble. The NIV says that there is to be nothing in us to make him stumble. And the one thing that we know, listen, if we love loud, we are not a stumbling block. But if you love loud, listen, and it's a bad thing, by the way, it's bad enough that a loveless life hurts you. The bad news in all of this, according to what John says, is that it also hurts other people. So when I am not a loving, kind, caring believer in Jesus Christ, it is not only hurting me and my effectiveness in the church, it is not only stifling the movement of the Holy Spirit in our church, but it is also a bad example to other believers in Jesus Christ, and it hurts them. In Romans chapter 14 and verse 13, it says that we are to resolve this, not to put up a stumbling block or a cause to fall in our brother's way. When you love less, ladies and gentlemen, that's what happens. You see, when you love loud, it makes you a stepping stone. In other words, it elevates people, and they were able to step on. Well, that sounds bad, but we're stepping stones. I was going too far with that. Loving loud makes us stepping stones, and hate makes us stumbling blocks. Do you want to help or do you want to hurt? Do you want to uplift or do you want to downgrade? It's our choice. And our choice must begin with biblical love. And the best way, listen, if we really care about others, the best way to help others not to stumble is to love them. How many of you want to help others? We've got to make a commitment today to love. To love the way the Bible says that we are to love. I know it's not easy. In fact, love can be a very difficult thing, especially when you've been hurt, especially if you're carrying baggage, especially if someone has said something that distracted you or in some way was hurtful in your life. It's a difficult thing to do, but we can help others. We can help them. And it's tragedy because when we choose to love less, we're going to be a stumbling block. Now, I know what everybody thinks. Most of us here think that we have a right to get upset. We have a right to get mad. I want to tell you right now, listen to me. When I'm talking about love, I'm not talking about agreeing with everything that another person does. You can still love and disagree with the choices that another person makes, right? You can disagree with that. For instance, this week at camp, I was so excited when I heard that we had soda pop in the refrigerator, right? And I looked, and we had Dr. Pepper. I like Dr. Pepper. We had root beer. I like root beer. And then we had Pepsi. Gross. I mean, Pepsi should not even be characterized as a soda pop. Anybody with common sense knows that Pepsi tastes like dog water. You say, how do you know what dog water tastes like? Don't ask. Now, do you know what I did when I looked in the refrigerator and I saw that there was Pepsi and no Coca-Cola? Coca-Cola is the real thing. I know that. I saw it on commercial, Katrina. I know it's the right stuff. And when you feel the Coca-Cola burn, there is nothing like it. I ought to get paid for this, right? We have Coca-Cola bottlers here in town. We have something. Anyway, never mind. Now, I want to tell you, listen, my feelings were hurt. Only Pepsi. My feelings were hurt. But do you know what happened? I got over it. Because I love people, right? And we get over things when we love people. It's a matter of mind over matter. Now, that's not an easy thing to have happen. If you don't mind, it don't matter, right? And I looked at that sort of refrigerator full of Pepsis. So many Pepsis. So many Pepsis. And I saw that refrigerator full of so many Pepsis. You know what I decided? I'm just going to drink water. And that ended up being a lot better for me. So anyway, listen, I'm being silly about that. I really don't care whether they're Pepsis or not. But what I'm here to tell you is, when things don't go your way, we forgive. We move on. We say it's not a big deal, right? It's not a big deal. That's what we're to do. When you choose not to love, you become a stumbling block. So it is tragic when we love less because of where you'll live in darkness. It is tragic because of what you'll be, a stumbling block. And it is also tragic, thirdly, this morning, I want you to remember this, because of what you'll become. Look at the tragedy of loving less. And we find this in verse 11. It says, but he who hates his brother is in darkness and walks in darkness and does not know where he is going because of the darkness, the Bible says, has blinded his eyes. It says he is in darkness and he walks in darkness. The result is he does not know where he is going. Now, some of you may not know, but our oldest son, Corey, is vision impaired. My son, Eli, is here. Came to see his dad on Father's Day. The good son. But Corey has a vision problem. When he was in high school, he would still go on dates, and he would take his date to the movie theater, and he wouldn't be able to see very much at all. And as a vision-impaired person, he does pretty well in getting along. Most people wouldn't know that this is his problem, but he still tried to live his life in the best way he knew how, and so he took his girlfriend to the movies. Well, he got caught as he went back to go to the bathroom before the movie started. That moment when they turn out all the lights and everything's pretty dark in the theater. You guys know what I'm talking about, right? And so he was walking gingerly on his way back, kind of figuring out where his date was sitting. And all of a sudden, he hit the wall and he fell on the ground. And I mean, he was dazed and stunned. And he looked up and he said, is anybody there? And a lady said, well, I guess so, just like that. He couldn't see. And his vision in the dark that was already impaired, that already gave him problems, listen, led to more problems. And he hit the ground. Now, I'm glad that he can laugh at things like that, and we still laugh at that story even to this day. I'm glad that he can talk about that and have a smile on his face. But friends, I want to tell you, listen, when you stumble around in darkness, it is not a funny thing. Another camp story, Brother Jay. Mamas with your boys. I know your boys are very clean when they're at home. Amen. Can you mamas say amen to that for me? Is that the truth? I'm not getting much support from you mamas. Now this makes sense. But in the dorm, there were two long lines to make your way to the back. I had no facilities to powder my nose in the middle of the night. And so when I got up, I'd have to climb out of my bed. On the final night, I fell down and busted my face. But then making my way through there, our little darlings would not always pick their shoes up. And so they'd be in the middle of the aisle. Now, it's not as bad as the Lego thing, you know, when you have kids with Legos. Whoever invented Legos, listen, they must be in the church of Satan. I'm pretty sure of that. But as I made my way back, listen, there were you couldn't see anything. The lights were out. I didn't want to turn the lights on. And there was a side of me, the devious side of me, the loveless side of me that said, after stumbling over that first shoe or tripping over that next pair of underwear, whatever it was, there was a loveless side of me that said, I'm just going to turn the lights on and let them suffer. But I was in the darkness. And I would stumble. This is why it's important to keep our shoes under the bed, right? I'm preaching this sermon way too late. And that's what happens. When we love less in our life, we walk around in spiritual darkness, even as believers. Mind you, John is speaking to Christians here. And he is saying to Christians, when you love less, you are walking in darkness. Whatever light was in you is gone. It has disappeared. It is no longer there. We need light. One of my least favorite things that I was asked to do when I was a child in my parents' house was working in my mama's garden. Any of you guys remember those days? We had a garden out in front, right in front of our porch, and then in front of our house, and it was filled with all kinds of goodies that my mother loved planting through the year, and she'd put the mulch in and all these other things in, but eventually there'd get to be a point that the grass would creep through, and I hated having the job of weeding the garden. I'd try to find reasons to get up at 7 in the morning and take off on my bike so I wouldn't have to weed the garden. That would be my sister's duty. But, you know, gardeners know this. They know that their garden needs water. And a gardener wants water in their garden. But more importantly, that garden needs light. And you must have light for the garden to grow. If there's nothing but darkness and there is no light at all, the garden will die. So light, listen to me, it is conducive to garden growth. Similarly, for a Christian, we need light to grow. Do you know why some Christians stay bitter and embroiled in a fleshly attitude? It's because they're walking in darkness. They're not walking in the light, or they have very little light in their life. Some people attend church their whole lives and walk in darkness. It may very well be the case that this person does not know Jesus Christ as their personal Lord and Savior. A lack of light hinders the growth of a garden. A lack of light hinders growth in a believer's life. And I'm here to tell you today that hatred in the heart of a believer will hinder your potential growth. It even affects our marriages. I was passing a cabin today, and this week at camp, and I recognized the name of the church at the cabin. And when Katrina and I first got married, the guy that was the longtime pastor there told me, when I told him our story, we met, fell in love quick, and got married quick. And he said to me, "Your marriage won't last." Said that to me. Now, I'll tell you, the loveless out of me at that moment said, "I want to jack this sucker's jaw for saying that." But I didn't say anything. I was gracious, kept my mouth shut, and eventually forgave him. But many marriages are doomed to fail. And the reason a number of marriages are doomed to fail is because of loving less. In other words, if a marriage is filled with unforgiveness and keeping a record of wrongs, it will not survive. It will not survive. One of the ways that I know that my wife loves me, and I am more in love with her more today than I've ever been in my life, is because she knows every wart in my life. She knows virtually every ugly thing about me, and she still chooses to love me. That's a blessing, ladies and gentlemen. And many of our marriages, we keep a bulleted list of everything that the other person has done wrong. and we don't forget. We don't forgive. We hold that over each other's head forever and ever and ever. Many troubled marriages, people in those marriages will say, we're not happy. There's no joy in their house. Well, I want to tell you, listen, if you live in a house where you can't forgive each other, it's no wonder. And the same thing goes in our regular relationships. Many times, churches are ruined because we keep a list of things that another person has done that has offended us. And we remember it forever. We do not forgive. We say, this is the way that person is, and because that person is that way, I'm not going to love them. Do you realize that John is condemning us this morning when we have that attitude? Shouldn't be that way. Fact of the matter is, listen, when you nurse a grudge, it will poison your relationship, whether it's in your marriage or whether it is in a friendship or in a relationship, and it will certainly poison a church. Churches that hold grudges eventually die. And if we hold grudges here at Grandview Baptist Church, it doesn't matter if Billy Graham himself is called to be pastor in this church. This church will die. Paul said in the book of 1 Corinthians in chapter 13 and verse 5, love thinks no evil. Think about this. In other words, love never keeps a record of the things that others do to hurt us. Keys for all of us to remember this morning would be this. Instead of keeping a record of the things that hurt, start remembering the things that please. Start remembering the good things. In fact, it says in the book of Philippians that we're to think on the good things, right? You want a blessing from God? Think on the good things. Think on the good things that God has done in your life. Think on the good experiences that you have had in this church. Think on the good things of other people that you know. Think on those things. Record them. Don't remember the things that are bad. An unforgiving spirit breeds bitterness and poison, but a loving spirit chooses to remember the very best. Simon Peter said in 1 Peter chapter 4 and verse 8, and above all things have, listen to this, fervent love for one another. And that's not just saying, hey, I love you. It's more than that. Fervent love. This is a commitment, a passionate kind of love. Above all things, he said, have a fervent love for one another. This is a guy that would have known with his best friends during most of Jesus' ministry, they spent a lot of the time arguing who is going to be closest to Jesus, who is the best out of all of them, who is the best disciple, who is going to sit closest to him in heaven. They were arguing over all kinds of things. Finally, Simon Peter learned his lesson. We must have a fervent love. For love, listen to this, will cover a multitude of sins. 2,000 years ago, we see the perfect picture of the sacrificial love of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. And we see his sacrificial love as his nail, as the nails are hammered into his hands and into his feet, as the Bible teaches that he shed his blood for our sin. Why? He was our atoning Savior. He paid the price. And Jesus' loving act on the cross covered a multitude of our sins. Folks, I want to tell you, listen, if there's anybody God ought to be mad at, it ought to be me. If there's anybody that God ought to strike off of his list, it ought to be me. If there's anybody that God ought to say, I don't want to have anything to do with you ever, it ought to be me. But God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whoever, now listen, I'm not going to delve into the Greek there, but you know what whoever means? That means me too. That's good news. Whoever believes in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. Listen to me. That's not only me, that's you. And those early Christians, they believed it. They fervently loved one another. That's why they would bring drunkards into the family of God, and they would love them into the kingdom, and we would see them give their hearts and lives to Jesus Christ. That's why people who were thieves were accepted into the early New Testament church, people who were known thieves, and yet that early New Testament church would love them as Jesus would love them, and they would give their hearts and lives to Jesus Christ. That's why immoral people were accepted into the kingdom of God in the early New Testament church, because they believed in this matter, in this fact of this thing that we call love, and they were brought into the kingdom of God by love and passion. That's why they accepted prostitutes into the early New Testament church, and they accepted them, and they loved them, and they came into the kingdom of God. I've never told you guys this. When I first started attending church, once again, when I was a high school student, my first Sunday in church, I had one of the most glorious mullets that the world has ever seen. Oh, yeah, baby. I'm telling you. And I didn't know how you're supposed to talk. I didn't know how you're supposed to act. I couldn't have quoted to you John 3:16. But I knew I was going to wear my favorite shirt that Sunday morning. Do you know what my favorite shirt was? My Ted Nugent Double Live Gonzo concert t-shirt. And I wore that into church. Kind of expecting, Jay, somebody say something to me. But you know what happened? The pastor came up and he loved on me. Showed me where my Sunday school class was. I went up and my youth minister was teaching Sunday school that morning. He loved on me. The people in that church building that Sunday, they loved on me. And you know what I said? I think I want to come back. And it wasn't because that church was the prettiest church in town. It wasn't because they had the most people in town. It was because they spoke the language of love. And I returned time after time after time after time. I attended church for the next year and a half until finally the point came where that message of love broke into my cold, callous heart, and I realized that not only did they love me, but God loved me, and God sent his son Jesus to die for me. And I knew right then that the night I gave my heart and life to Jesus, I knew right then that I needed to be saved. And so I repented. I turned from the way that I was living, and I turned to Jesus. That's what repentance is. I turned to Jesus, and I decided on that very night that I wanted to follow him for the rest of my life. And I want to tell you, listen to me, Jesus turned me upside down. And immediately I felt what that love was all about when all the burden and sin in my life was taken off of my shoulders and it was replaced by the love of God. I want to tell you, listen, I'm not just preaching a sermon rhetorically to you this morning, but I want to tell you, listen, it is something that I've experienced. And it is something that we can all experience. Who would turn away the love of God? Who would turn away this kind of love that we speak of? If you don't know Jesus as your Lord and Savior, listen, today when we have this invitation here in the next few minutes, that's when we have our instrumentalists come forward. And then I'm going to stand at the front and I'm going to offer a word of prayer and I'm going to pray for you. Listen, if you don't know that love and you don't know Jesus, listen, make a beeline down to the front. And today we can introduce you to him. Maybe you're here and you've already trusted in Jesus to be your Lord and Savior, but you want to make it public. You say, why is it important to make it public? Well, Jesus said it's important. He said, if you deny me before men, I'll deny you before my Father who is in heaven. But if you confess me before men, he said, I will confess you before my Father who is in heaven. That's why public response is always important. And if that's you, we want to encourage you to come today as well. Maybe you're a Christian and you've been struggling. Or you know someone that's struggling and you want to pray for them. Great things happen in these altars. I am here today because I had a grandmother who prayed for me weekly. And I'm a child of God because of that. Many of you have similar stories, maybe as a grandfather or your mom or dad or a friend in school. But they prayed for you and those prayers were answered. That can be answered in your life today. And you can pray for people today that you know that need to experience this. We want to encourage you to do what the Lord leads. So let's stand together. Heads bowed and eyes closed. I'm going to lead us in a word of prayer. And when I finish praying, our music team is going to be here at the front. We're here on the platform. And we're going to have an invitation song. And the invitation is going to begin the minute I end my prayer. And that will be your time to step out and to make a decision for Christ, or make public a decision that you have already made. So you come now in this next minute. Pray with me, if you will. Heads bowed and eyes closed. Lord, we come before you in Christ's name. And as we are here, Father, I know I don't love perfectly, but I want to love as much like Jesus as possible. Forgive me for my rottenness. Forgive me for those times when I can't see past your grace and extend the same grace that you've extended to me. Let me love in a way that pleases and honors you. And let us all do the same. There are people in my life right now that I know need the Lord and need to experience his love. And as their names enter into my mind right now, Lord, I pray that it would go to heaven's throne and you would hear. You would open the door of faith and love into their life. There are Christians I know right now that are struggling. And I'm praying for them right now. In my mind, you know their names, and I lift them up to you. And many of us who are here have people like that that we know, and we want to pray for them. Or maybe it's us. I can remember years ago I was struggling with bitterness and anger about another person. And it led me to have nightmares, and it began to affect my life. I finally had to get to the point to where, Lord, you remember where I had to come before you and just say, Lord, I forgive that person, even though I didn't feel like it. I forgive them, and your love just filled my heart at that moment. And I believe there may be someone here that needs to experience that right now. Others need Jesus. Others need to make public a decision. Whatever it is, we pray that it would happen now according to your word, your will, and your way. We ask this now in Christ's name. Amen and amen. Come now as the Lord leads. Come now. Mom, Dad, brother, sister, child of God, would you come now? Make your way to the front. Make a decision for him. No matter how young you are, no matter how old, come today and follow him. Katrina will stand at your side. She'll talk for you. She doesn't know how this works.
That's what we're all going to teach her.
All right.
Keely, and she gave her heart to Jesus
Friday
night. And she's going to get baptized. We're probably going to hope your grandma probably wants to be here. I told her we're all here for her. We're her net. She can call any of us anytime, any day or hour, and we're going to love you, and you're in the family now. So this is your family.
All right, all you scary people that are staring back at Keely right now, if you're excited about that and you're in favor of her getting baptized when the time is right, would you say amen?
Amen.
All right, amen. Listen, we love you. She can go back and sit if she wants to. It's freaky standing up here. I'm telling you right now, it's freaky. All right, listen, we love you. Thank you, Keely. All right, listen, we're going to close with a word of prayer. Parents who are here, thank you for allowing us to borrow your kids for a week. They really were great. We had a lot of good times, a lot of belly laughs, and so many, you know, 99.9% of the time, they were on board with everything that we wanted to do. I'll take that any day. Amen. I'll take that any day. So thank you again. Thank you for allowing them to come. We had a great week. I can't wait until next year. So anyway, I'm going to be ready. I'm going to be in fighting shape next year. All right. Anyway, listen, we love you. We're going to close with a word of prayer, and then after we pray, we will be dismissed. Men, don't forget, we've got a gift for you in the back, so make sure you pick that up. It'll be on the table right by where I'm standing. Brother Rick, could you close us in prayer?